Hello and welcome to round 11 here at the World Championship. I'm Tim Willoughby, here with Hall of Famer Randy Buehler. We've got the last format of the weekend and the players are ready, so we're going to head right down there for round 11 of the World Championships. Hello and welcome to round 11 of the World Championship here. We're about to start our first standard round, so let's meet our players.
Hi, I'm Ivan Floch. I am from Slovak Republic and I am Pro Tour M15 champion.
Sam Black, United States of America, pro player at large.
And here we have our players there. Ivan Floch, he's made two top eights this season playing blue-black control. Now we're in standard. Are we going to expect to see anything different, Randy Buehler?
No, I would absolutely put him on blue-black control all day, all the time.
Now that's interesting because Sam Black, his opponent there, I was talking to him first thing this morning. He said, I've been practicing online a lot. I've been looking at the online metagame. If someone's playing control against me, I could be in a bit of trouble.
Yeah, Sam seemed not super happy with his preparation for this tournament when I was sitting next to you having breakfast with him. He's afraid that he may have metagamed against Magic Online instead of metagaming against the 23 guys he's competing against here this weekend. And yeah, he has in fact run into the blue-black control deck that doesn't show up a lot on Magic Online and is not a good matchup for him.
Now, this is the one round of Standard where the players sat down not knowing what their opponents were playing. From
exactly.
This round onward, they will be able to get a chance to look at deck lists. But for this round, it's only taken one turn for Ivan Floch to get all the information. He's got the thoughts. He's there looking at a hand with two copies of Hordling Outburster, Master of the Way, and yeah, he's got the sort of classic red-white tokens build.
Yeah, Seeker of the Way, Wingmate Rock. Dusley, it's a red-white tokens deck. Ivan might suspect that it's Mardu rather than just red-white, but I mean, everything here is merely red and white.
And how does Control match up against the tokens deck?
You've got Perilous Vault. So, Ivan, when he top aided at the Pro Tour in Hawaii, their version of the list did not play Perilous Vault. That was sort of Andrew Cuneo and the Pantheon had put Perilous Vault into the list. And Ivan has now gone that way. So he's got Perilous Vault to kind of sweep everything away. That's definitely the sweeper. Meanwhile, he's got a bunch of one-for-one removal spells. The tokens are actually a little better against blue-black control than, you know, random creatures would be, because you can't one-for-one them. Like, you can't really trade one removal spell for one of their cards.
So there's Seeker of the Way from Sam Black. He's got another copy of Hordling Outburst in hand, so we're likely to see one of them fairly soon.
But another Hordling. We'll see another Thoughtseize. This is how you trade one card for one token generating card.
Now, a lot of players worry about the damage that you might take off Thoughtseize, especially against aggressive decks. But here, everyone he's playing is just saving him damage, right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, no, these guys play three Thoughtseize main. They also play a couple Despises main. The goal with blue-black control, you just need to trade cards, because your mid-game and your late-game is awesome. Three copies of Jace's Ingenuity, four copies of Dig Through Time. You're going to pull ahead if you just get to the point where you have five, six, seven mana in play.
So if Ivan Floch gets to a bunch of lands in play and isn't nearly dead, then he's almost certainly winning.
Yeah, he wins. That's his victory condition.
So there, a temple, just letting him get a little bit of scry, make sure that he can draw the cards he needs on time every time. And a Monastery Swift Spear here, a tempting option for Sam Black, who now no longer has any Hordling Outbursts to work with. Just two in that attack there from the Seeker of the Way.
I think he's going to play Heliod's Pilgrim here.
Now, what targets has he got to search for with that Pilgrim?
He's actually got Eidolon of the Countless Battles in his deck. Three different copies. He's got Chain to the Rocks in his deck, so he can go get that. It's effectively a tutor spell to go get either removal or a creature. Those are the two primary targets. There's not really, you know, a one of Silver Bullets package. Just those two targets, really.
Now, it looks like we did just see a Chain to the Rocks added to Sam Black's hand there. What sort of targets are there likely to be from a blue-back control deck?
There's basically nothing. Prolake Ancient.
Best of luck hitting that one.
Yeah.
I mean, that may be just a concession to the fact that the Eidolon of Countless Battles not necessarily a great pick either in this matchup.
Yeah, I mean, I guess he's thinning his library of cards that are terrible to draw.
But Ivan Floch here, having
And he doesn't actually know. Like, we know exactly what Ivan is on. Sam doesn't necessarily. I mean, he clearly suspects. He's seen blue-black. He knows what Floch top-aided the Pro Tour with. I'm sure he's got him on blue-black control most likely, but it's not 100%, so I don't know. Maybe you throw a chain in your hand.
And Floch here, just playing a land and passing. Not really representing too much in the way of counter spells with that mana, because the Evolving Wilds, it's going to fetch a land tapped, so at best a disdainful stroke, I suppose.
Yeah, I mean, the trick for Sam here is figuring out how much he can actually commit to the board. He's got to worry about sweepers like Drown in Sorrow or End Hostility, or not End Hostility's Perilous Vault.
So there's Monastery Swift Spear. That's got haste, so it's going to be able to hit in for one alongside the Heliod's Pilgrim and that Seeker of the Way. And there's a chain.
Oh, he got the chain so that he could trigger Prowess. Hilarious. That's what Chain to the Rocks does. Plus one to the Seeker, plus one to the Monastery Swift Spear.
That's interesting. Yeah, I would not have seen that line.
No, he basically got a mutagenic growth. Just take two extra. I did not. Yeah, I didn't see it until he played it. That's pretty funny.
And Ivan Floch now down to single digits. This is what the red-white deck wants to achieve. And there's Chandra Pyromaster in Black's hand, which will potentially be able to be another source of card advantage if these first threats do get dealt with. Ivan Floch, he's going to need to do something pretty soon here. We see a dig through time there in his hand. But not a huge amount else, really. Radiant Fountain stems the bleeding a little bit, but...
No, he either needs to point removal spells at those creatures, or he needs to get to a Perilous Vault.
Now, of course, Ivan Floch, hugely experienced with this deck. He's not likely to show that he's too worried until it's a really dire situation.
Right.
I'm not sure in his mind whether or not this qualifies.
I mean, he's running out of time for Perilous Vault, because it takes one turn to play it, and then takes another turn to activate it. I don't think it's fast enough at this point. And he kind of wants to, yeah, he's going to dissolve anything. It didn't even matter what spell Sam played there. It was getting dissolved so that he could scry. But again, that's a prowess trigger.
So big attacks here. Ivan Floch taking a little bit more damage.
I'm not sure how Floch gets out of this.
Yeah, it looks like we might be moving to sideboards fairly quickly. This is exactly the start that Sam Black was looking for here.
Yes, yes. I mean, the most likely way for him to win this matchup is just come out, beat him up before he can take control. That is the plan. It's just scary when you're committing, you know, 3-4 cards to the board and you know your opponent can sweep them all away with something like a Perilous Vault.
It's interesting because we were talking a little bit before over the break about how people might choose decks specifically for this tournament, because you've only got 24 players. There's a little bit more room to think about what individual players like, but there's a lot of temptation to just go with something solid in the sort of middle range that's not necessarily going to lose to the really quick decks or necessarily be too big a dog to the control decks at either end.
Yeah, this standard is really interesting. There's a lot of mid-range decks. But the fact that there are so many different flavors of mid-range decks is kind of interesting in and of itself, because they match up against each other differently. You can go super aggressive if you want to. You can go with kind of a Rabble Red or Boss Sly. You can go with a White-Blue Heroic that can be very aggressive. There are these token strategies, which are kind of almost mid-rangey, but can come out super aggressively as well. There's a lot of room for play, especially if you can predict the metagame.
So here we see another Heliod's Pilgrim, and I think we might be about to see the same play that we saw earlier on.
Agreed.
Chain to the Rocks being used as a pump spell. Yeah, these are the sorts of decks that give you a little bit of flexibility, a little bit of room to make good plays, and that kind of the absolute core of what people are looking to be doing in these World Championships, show off their talent. These are the best players in the world squaring off for the grand prize.
It also makes sideboarding really interesting. I mean, a lot of decks might have a super aggressive main deck, but then they've got some sweepers in their sideboard. They've got an Anger of the Gods, or they're Drown in Sorrow, often because they can't beat a Hornet Queen any other way. And yeah, here Sam's just getting in the attack. He wins game one.
So the first game for Sam Black, he's going to be reaching to his sideboard trying to figure out what to go in the next game. But before we take a live look in, we're going to just get a couple of messages for you.
Ultra Pro is the place to go for all your Magic accessories. With card sleeves, deck boxes, playmats, and portfolios showing off the best Magic art, Ultra Pro is the standard in safe storage. Visit ultrapro.com for more information. hump bigger game by playing in a Grand Prix. These open tournaments feature the best players in your region as well as top Magic pros from around the world. Upcoming Grand Prix include Baltimore, Milan, Denver, Manila, Omaha, and Shizuoka. Visit magic.wizards.com/Grand Prix for a complete schedule.
And we're back as the players in our main match take their sideboard. We're going to have a little bit of a look in on the match between Josh Utterleighton and Lars Dahm. Now, I know that speaking to Frank Karsten before this round started, he was saying, well, the Dutch team are very keen to see whether or not Josh has done it again and broken another format after having seen his modern deck.
Sure.
But on the left of our screen, it looks like he's playing a Sidisi Whip deck. This is a deck that did very well in Stockholm up against Dahm, who's on Jeskai Control. And we can already see both Ashiok and a copy of Whip of Erebos dealt with there by Banishing Light from Dahm, who has a full grip, and we don't quite know the life totals, but with plenty of lands in play and plenty of cards, I can't help but think that Dahm's not in a terrible spot here.
Yeah, and he's discarding. That's how many cards he's got in his hand. Shivan Reef to the graveyard. Lars is at 18. Wow.
And also, like, not taking any damage yet. There's still plenty of play in this game.
It's already Pearl Lake Ancient Time.
Oh.
It's the victory cigar for these control decks. Yeah, once it's time to attack with Pearl Lake Ancient, they're just cleaning up. Probably a grip full of answers. Not looking good for Raptor.
And of course, Josh on Channel Fireball, he knows how quickly Pearl Lake Ancient can end things because many of the Channel Fireball guys were playing Pearl Lake Ancient as their finisher of choice in control decks. So not necessarily Jeskai control, but...
Yeah, no, this Jeskai list is interesting. I haven't really seen the Jeskai taken all the way over to the, you know, end hostilities, edge of the spectrum.
It may well be that Sam Black's choice to play a deck that's a little soft to control might be one that he chooses to rue, though obviously a game up currently
there's
in his main
There's not a
lot match.
Of it. There's only... I've now sort of scanned the list of who's playing what quickly. This is the only Jeskai control deck, and there's a couple of blue-black controls. You know, it might be 10% of the field, but it's not much more than that.
I mean, 10% of the field here is two or three players, isn't it, really?
Right, exactly.
But yeah, Josh is going to have to do some work if he's going to get back in this one with Pearl Lake Ancient doing its thing.
You know, the entire Channel Fireball, what are they, a pentet? I don't know what the five of them.
Quintet.
Quintet, thank you. The five of them are all on Sidisi Whip. So Sidisi Whip is one of the most played decks. It looks like there's a lot of obs on midrange. There's the five of them on Sidisi Whip, and there may be one or two others. Those are the two most played decks, it looks like.
Some very robust finishes here from Lars Dahm. He's also got Prognostic Sphinx there, which...
Jeez.
Diversifying his ways of finishing the game, but between the two of them, they will finish that game very, very quickly indeed. As Josh Utterleighton here, as much as he's getting through his deck, he's not necessarily finding too many ways of battling back here. Soul of Innistrad there, potentially getting him back some creatures.
Sure. I mean, the Sidisi Whip deck can be extremely powerful when you get it up and running, but if you're able to kind of pick it apart. You know, they need to get some stuff in the graveyard. They need to stick a whip. If they can't get a whip into play, well, okay, maybe Sidisi all by herself is good enough. If you fight those two cards, though, I mean, the rest of the deck without either a whip or a Sidisi, it's not awesome.
Yeah, you need a bit of fuel for that tank, and it's not necessarily all there. I mean, it looks like the Banishing Lights here for Dahm have been decisive. Both of those threats that have been dealt with, Ashiok and the whip itself, potentially quite difficult for many decks to deal with.
True.
Because
there's Hornet Queens, too, which are also difficult. So, I mean, I may be underselling the resilience of the Sidisi Whip deck. That said, Lars has clearly dispatched all the threats.
But, I mean, we now see that there appears to be a Hornet Queen and Sidisi herself coming back thanks to Soul of Innistrad.
Mm-hmm. Doomwake Giant is the third choice.
This game is not over yet. Sidisi there, putting a few cards into Josh's graveyard. A Murderous Cut, and it looks like a couple of copies of Course of Crucifix there. Which, as he hit at least one creature, he gets at least one creature back, and that creature's a 2/2 zombie. But the Pearl Lake Ancient and the Prognostic Sphinx are going to be able to crash in pretty soundly, even into that board.
Oh, wow. Anger.
Triggering prowess.
Wipe your board and trigger prowess.
Let's not forget that this Pearl Lake Ancient is skilled in the art of fighting. Every spell that gets cast does make it a little bit bigger.
Lars has been so much fun to watch. this whole tournament. Here's lightning strike your face.
And thinking that about Josh, there was a great moment in the players' meeting the night before the tournament where Lars was desperately looking around for his fate stitches.
Yes.
And we all know, of course, now that Josh was all over the fate stitcher plan.
Yes.
The moment that Lars asked Josh if he had any fate stitches that he could borrow.
Yep.
Was incredible in retrospect, because I had no clue at that point that that's what Josh was doing, and nothing was given away on his face. But we're going to get another look in here. This is, on the left of our screen, Jacob Wilson. He's playing an Abzan deck of one stripe or another up against
mid-range.
Raphael Levy. Levy there with a Raphael Levy Platinum Pro token.
Nice.
Presumably a goblin off that Goblin Rabble Master that's in his graveyard, and three copies of Monastery Swift Spear there, which ordinarily would present quite a hefty amount of damage, but with...
Yeah, we're pretty deep into the game for the mono-red deck, though. Elspeth has had time to come down. The time for attacking with Swift Spears and Goblins is probably over.
And Siege Rhino, not really what the aggressive red decks want to see. That,
I mean, just Brimaz would have been a big problem. The curve just kept going up from there.
And, of course, that Course of Crucifix in play, meaning we're getting a great view of the top of Jacob Wilson's deck. We get to see everything that's coming. So does Raphael Levy, and I can't imagine he's super happy about everything that he's seeing here.
Yeah, these guys are 5-5, too, so they're both probably thinking of this as an elimination match. And I think everyone thinks, I got to get to 9-5, and then, okay, you know, we'll look at it. Maybe that's good enough, maybe it's not, but I got to get to 9-5 is what everyone's thinking.
Yeah, because unlike most tournaments where top 8 is good enough, here you've got to get to the top 4, and... There's a little bit of flexibility there, depending on how the best player's doing, sort of how the slots
where
drop
the line
down.
Comes,
but,
yeah.
But yeah, if you've got more than 5 losses, it's over.
Right. Yeah, most people look at the 6 losses fatal.
Though that said, you still want to play every round, because there is a pro point for every win.
Yeah, it's funny. I talked to Patrick Chapin this morning over breakfast. He was, you know, Pat, you're 7-0. Are you starting to think about, you know, how many wins do you actually need today? And he's like, there's a pro point every round. I want 7 wins.
We already know, of course, that Chapin hasn't managed to pick up the full perfect record. He's picked up a couple of losses in draft, now back to standard, which was a format that he feels pretty confident about.
He said standard was his best format. He's going to need it now. I mean, that 1-2, he's starting to sweat a little bit. Probably only needs one more win, but there's a chance he needs 2 more.
Absolutely, and it looks like we've got another match in the bag there. Wilson able to take that one over Levy.
Yeah, Jacob's on a bit of a hot streak. He's won 4 in a row. 3-0'd his draft, won his last round last night. I mean, he was in dire straits late, but he's rattled off 4. 4 more? He could actually be playing on Sunday.
So it looks like in our main match, they're just finishing up the shuffling. They should be ready to play pretty shortly. But quite a lot of shuffling going on. It seems like we've got some synchronized magic in our feature match area. Just the one match where there's still... Yep. Games being played, but it looks like with opening hands being drawn, we are going to get a chance to go back to our main match. On the left of our screen, Ivan Floch. On the right, Sam Black.
6 cards for Sam.
Yeah, 6 cards. It's a lot harder for the aggro decks to get back in that.
Keeps, I think, one land, one temple as his land.
I mean, if you're going to keep a one land hand, then a temple's a great one to keep. You get that scry, you get a little bit of a better chance to hit your curve. But here, Polluted Delta finding a swamp for Ivan Floch. And if there's a Despise rather than a Thoughtseize, but one way or another, he's going to get a chance to strip something out of Sam Black's hand here.
Whoa.
We have a big result.
Pat Chapin wins 2-0 already. That was quick. Yeah. And if 9-5 really is the line, then congratulations to Pat Chapin. That is win number 9. First place all by himself and probably in top 4 position.
The innovator said when he won the Pro Tour earlier in the season that he saw it as being a qualifier for the World Championship. He qualified for the World Championship, and he's been leading from the front since the start.
Definitely.
Didn't seem to like the idea of sharing that lead with anyone and has just taken it back for his own.
No, those guys have actually played 2 rounds in a row. Yamamoto won the last round of the draft, and now Patrick returns the favor in standard.
Dismal backwater there from Ivan Floch. And so far, Sam Black, he's found the lands he needs, so he's got a Seeker of the Way on time on turn 2, though he did lose a Seeker of the Way to that Despise.
Wow, no third land drop for Floch.
So as much as we were talking about there potentially being mana issues on the right-hand side of our table, Floch missing lands is probably a bigger deal overall, because... His is the deck that's wanting to get up to 5, 6, 7 lands, whereas if it turns out that Sam Black is stuck on 3, he's got plenty he can do from there.
Agreed. Flock's got drown, though. He's probably not going to get run over. I assume that Dismal Backwater is just left over, is the one that's in play, and that our display is a turn behind. Can't imagine he would not play a land.
Though, every now and again, you do hear about the hold back on lands to get a bit of an overcommitment to really sell your wrath.
And there's the third land. Anyway, Sam Black had that happen. Lars Dom was actually slow rolling lands because he saw on Sam's deck list in Limited that he was playing two Rakshasa's Secrets and had just a million removal spells. So Lars was holding his lands to discard and basically just stopped playing lands at three and held them in
hand. That's really smart play. I've seen a lot of very disciplined play, actually, from Lars Dom across this entire tournament. Even in the Vintage Masters, sort of just carefully pacing all of his removal to make sure that he could just run Jeremy Tazani out of threats. But they're a Raise the Alarm, getting some tokens for Sam Black. So he's now got a comparatively busy board, only briefly troubled by a Hero's Downfall to kill his Secret of the Way.
Funny, as a response to an Arc Lightning, which was, again, triggering prowess.
And there's the Drown in Sorrow. Effectively a one-for-one here, dealing with the Raise the Alarm in one fell swoop and getting a scry on top of it. So Sam here, he's not really been able to get the kind of purchase at the start of the game that I guess he would have wanted. This time around, Ivan Floch,
About a mulligan and a despise.
and you know, some removal from Floch. I mean, this is what Floch wants to be doing against the aggro decks, is just saying, I can one for one a bit. Every now and again, I can two for one, and sooner or later, you're going to just run out of gas. Couple of copies of Stoke the Flames, Chandra Pyromaster, and a Wingmate Rock in Sam Black's hand.
Sam just declines to play Chandra into untapped mana. That was dissolve mana over there. He's like, nope, not casting this Chandra. I'll sit on Stoke the Flames.
So a dig through time here, meaning that Ivan Floch gets to one of the things that I'm sure he enjoys most in Magic, dealing out seven cards. Briefly, he holds them all in his hand. He only gets to keep two of them. He's going to pick his favorite two to add to what he's already working with. And we can see some good ones there. Pearl Lake Ancient, if he doesn't take it now, it's going to basically be on the bottom of his deck, which means that it might take him a bit of time to win the game. But there's also the likes of Jace's Ingenuity, another dig through time. He's got plenty of options here. Now, of course, Ivan Floch, one of the players who is going to be playing in the World Magic Cup as well this weekend.
The Dream Chasers. There are 11 of them, I believe.
Unsurprisingly, people that are playing in the World Championship quite likely to be the captain of their respective country's team.
Yep.
And there's both lands and spells to work here for him, for Ivan Floch. And he's got the Radiant Fountain. Now, that works particularly well with Pearl Lake Ancient that's in his hand. It means that potentially he can start returning that land to his hand to bounce his Ancient, replaying it, stemming a little bit of bleeding that might come from the red-white deck, so that rather than it having to just deal 20 damage, it might be having to deal 24, 26. And at some point, that really puts a bit of a strain on the burn spells from Sam Black's deck.
Yeah, it's kind of interesting how Sam has essentially set himself up as a burn deck here. Stoke still in the deck. Just one card, deal four damage.
So a negate there on Chandra Pyromaster, not allowing the Planeswalker to resolve. And at the start of the match, when we were talking about what Ivan Floch's deck needs to be doing to be winning, getting plenty of lands in play, staying at a relatively stable life total, keeping the board clear, that's exactly what's happening here.
Definitely. Sam's going to lead with a Swift Spear so we can follow up with a Hordling Outburst to trigger prowess, potentially.
And Floch having a little bit of a think here. I can't really think that he would be stopping the 1-2, but I guess that once it's in play, all of the creatures in Sam's deck are kind of homogenous in a way.
He has to kill all of them. It's just a question of how he wants to deal with them.
So here come the Goblins. 1-2-3 of Hordling Outburst, and that is a prowess trigger on the Monastery Swift Spear.
It's interesting how Sam kind of windmilled that. He went very quickly to the Hordling Outburst. I think that the fact that Floch paused to think about the Monastery Swift Spear, he's sort of representing permission. And the fact that he was so obviously representing it, I think convinced Sam that he did not, in fact, have any more counters in his hand. So Sam was confident his Hordling Outburst was going to resolve.
And that one of the big things in this tournament, all of these players are at such a high level that relatively nuanced reads on body language or sort of how people are playing things
up. Flash.
So many abilities on that Pearl Lake Ancient.
Swings down, picks off the Goblin in mid-combat.
I mean, Wingmate Rock does come after combat, and there is that extra token alongside it.
Yeah, those flyers can win this game in two attacks.
Yeah, Ivan Floch now down to just 10 life.
Does not actually have answers to the 3-4 flyers. Yeah, he'll have time, I guess, for either Jace's Ingenuity, or maybe he can dig through time. I don't know if he can do... The question is, does he have time to do both? He's kind of thinking right now, okay, do I want to draw three cards? Do I want to do anything main phase before I get attacked once? Do I want to ship the turn?
And he may find himself having to do the Pearl-like Ancient Radiant Fountain trick just to buy himself a little bit of time alongside whatever card drawing he's doing. The Barb Light kind of mocking him in his hand there, not quite able to deal with Wingmate Rock.
Right, right. I mean, I think he should... Jace's Ingenuity... I mean, this turn cycle... I mean, he can sit on Jace's Ingenuity. It's an instant, obviously. But he can draw three there. He can potentially cast something like a Blile Blight. He can build up a graveyard where he'd be able to dig and then still cast a removal spell. Again, though, I'm not sure Perilous Vault would have time to clear this board.
And that's probably the reason that we saw there was this sort of lack of clarity in the blue-black control decks when they first showed up. Not everyone was playing Perilous Vault, and the concern was it's a little bit slow sometimes.
Right. All right. I guess Yvonne.
Yeah, so
he's
going to
go main phase. I think we're in his main phase, right?
Treasure Cruise it ain't. This one costing him 5 mana to draw 3 cards. He does find a Hero's Downfall, so that's going to be a bit of a help here.
Right, and he finds a land that comes into play untapped. Which I think may have contributed to him doing this main phase. Yeah, Hero's Downfall's nice here. Now he's got... It buys him multiple turns.
Yeah, Pearl-like Ancient, unlikely to be going on the offensive all too soon. Sam Black's still on a full 20 life, and there's plenty of potential threats coming from that side of the table. So Stoke the Flames is in Sam's hand. He's drawn another Monastery Swift Spear.
Wow.
Speaking of haste...
Oh, yeah. Man, this game's right on the edge.
So that enough to prompt the Hero's Downfall on the real Wingmate Rock, if you will, rather than the bread token that came along with it.
Now, does Sam send his 3 ground creatures? Running the Swift Spear into the Pearl Lake to get through with two goblins? Probably yes. Those aren't going to do bad. I mean, getting 2 damage there, you get Flock to 5 with Stoke in hand, which... Sam has to decide whether to fire off while Flock is untapped, and yes is the answer. While you're tapped out.
Tantalizingly close to picking up the victory here. Just 1 life left for Ivan Floch. And Floch having a look through his graveyard. Up until recently, that was just a kind of, oh, let's figure out what I've drawn, but it could signal a little bit of delve action here from the Slovak player.
Yeah, Bile Blight can kill the 2 goblins. But he's got to come up with an answer to a 3-4 flyer. He's going to have to dig through time and find an answer. And because he's at 1, he's going to have to Bile Blight. That's 2 mana. He's going to have to dig. Let's see. If he Bile Blights, he will have 6 cards in his yard. So the dig is only 2. He'll have 4 mana left untapped. Plus, no lands in his hand. So, I think you Bile Blight, you dig, and you have to find an answer to a 3-4 flyer with your dig. Is he going to dig first?
I mean, I guess if you dig first, then it leaves you the option, if you want to, of doing the bounce your land and replay to effectively negate the damage from the goblins this turn.
Does it? He can't replay. It's 7 mana. Oh, it depends. I think there's only 5 cards in his yard right now. I think Bile Blight is the 6th card. It's possible. I think this dig costs 3. Yeah, if he Bile Blighted first, then he would save 1 on the dig. But he wants to dig first.
So in these 7 cards, you know, if you're going to have to roll a dice, then rolling it 7 times is not the worst, but...
What did he come up with?
Is that another Bile Blight?
Lands, Pearl Lake.
Q careful thought here from Ivan Floch, trying to figure out if there's a way he can get himself out of this situation that he's in.
There is a Bioblade in there.
Yes.
So that definitely buys him a turn, though it doesn't actually kill the 3-4 flyer.
There's an Aether Spouts as well.
Oh, that's Aether Spouts. I thought it was a Prolake. Aether Spouts is sexy.
Against all of those tokens, absolutely, because where normally, you know, they'd be getting put either on the top or the bottom of the deck, tokens just can't go there.
You know what the problem with Aether Spouts is, though? He doesn't have two blue. He doesn't have two blue.
Yeah, I mean...
his blue mana comes into play tapped. Yeah, yeah, I mean...
So it's Bile Blight as a fog this turn.
Mm-hmm.
Prepping for Aether Spouts next turn, but
that... the gain land, though, means he can actually block one goblin. He can actually take a goblin. He's not obliged to Bile Blight the goblins. Since he gained one up to two, he can kill one goblin, take one from the other.
Dismal backwater, doing work.
Doing work. And Sam's not interested in losing a goblin for one. But he's now very happy. He went to pick that up to take it off the board. The fact that it's only a Bile Blight, it's good news for Sam.
Just in case, he says.
Second Bile Blight. Let's kill it.
And I like that because it means that potentially you can hang back on your Aether Spouts quite a bit. The goblins on their own are not necessarily going to be as much of a problem here.
All true.
So Sam in top deck mode, but he's got the right kind of deck to find something that's going to deal two damage straight off the top.
Right, and Floch is down to just the Aether Spouts. He's got no permission for any burn spell that comes off the top of Sam's library.
So we were speaking earlier on about the importance of, at this level, getting a read on someone, getting a feel for what they're thinking. Mm-hmm. If Sam Black is trying to close this game out, is he just going to, if he finds a burn spell, just fire it off at the first instance, or perhaps try and get some kind of a read, maybe play a couple of spells in the same turn?
It's a fair question. I mean, the longer the game goes, the better it is for Floch, because Floch is the one who's got a bunch of Dig Through Times and Jace's Ingenuities in his deck. So when I think Sam knows this game is teetering right on the edge right now, Floch has started attacking with his Prolake. He's going to do the pickup Radiant Fountain trick this turn. That makes sense.
And Dismal Backwaters as well, just for a little bit of extra life gain.
Yeah, so I mean, Sam is not going to wait long to fire off any burn spell. I mean, he might wait end step, hope Floch casts a Dig Through Time or something. Yeah, Radiant Fountain picks up a couple of life. Here's the Prolake again.
And conspicuously leaves
Lightning
blue, blue,
Strike
black.
Off the top. Sam Black just drew Lightning Strike. These goblins are going to get in 1 point of damage, dropping a Floch to 3. And
oh,
now
wow.
Sam is like, you got it? No,
nope,
I got a
it.
Handshake for you. Wow. Nice draw from Sam Black there.
Yeah, sometimes you just need to draw the right card at the right time. That's why it's in the deck.
Yeah, that's not a great matchup for Sam. I mean, it's not a terrible matchup. He's able to sort of play this burn-heavy strategy where, you know, he can just pressure Floch's life total. But not a great matchup. Not the one Sam, I think, wanted coming in.
But that match now complete. We get a chance to see a little bit more of Josh Utter-Layton up against Lars Dahm. We saw last time we were here, Lars Dahm doing good work with Pearl Lake Ancient and Prognostic Sphinx. One of them has been traded just for another Prognostic Sphinx here, just for consistency. Up against the Sidisi Whip deck from Josh Utter-Layton, who he does have Sidisi in play. Doesn't have the Whip, but has plenty going on with Course of Crucifix. Another one on top, Sator Wayfinder, and a Reclamation Sage there that looks to have already dealt with a Banishing Light.
Mm. Yeah, I do see Banishing Light on the top of Lars's graveyard.
So we'll be able to get life totals in a moment or two on this one. Obviously, it's going to have a big impact on what Lars wants to do, though. He might be tempted to attack simply due to the fact that it gets him an awful lot of scrying, improves his draws quite a bit.
Yeah, attack with one, leave the other on defense. Makes a lot of sense.
There we can see the Prognostic Sphinx. One of the finishes of choice back in Pro Tour Journey into Nyx, where we were in Standard, as a relatively difficult to deal with threat, but still seeing some play in Standard now, even with a few other options available. So two sets of Scry 3 here going on here. It's not one big Scry 6. Lars gets to look at the top 3, put a few on top perhaps, then look at the top 3 again and figure out exactly what he wants to do there. Being very, very careful, of course, not to combine them with his hand. We don't want to have any awkward snafus on the rules here. And actually, one lovely thing about this tournament, we got 24 of the best players in the world. I think there's virtually been no judge calls at any point, even though we got some of the best judges here, if there were any. Aside from a couple of little bits and pieces yesterday about people not remembering that things were legends, we've been pretty clean. And Anger of the Gods here is going to do a good job of clearing Josh Atalayden's side of the board, leaving him with just a single copy of Course of Crucifix there, that revealing Disdainful Stroke on the top of Josh's deck.
This Lars Dom list is pretty interesting. 4 Anger, 3 End Hostility in the main. So 7 sweepers.
Well, that's sending a message, if nothing else.
Yeah. 4 Dissolves, 3 Steam Augury, and 1 Jace's Ingenuity.
So let's be under no illusions here. This is very much a control deck.
Oh, yeah. This is, you know, we see it a lot with Jeskai. Tempo, aggro, mid-range, fireworks, whatever. Now, this is a control deck.
And Thoughtseize reveals a very controlling hand. 2 copies of End Hostilities and that Disdainful Stroke there alongside a temple there.
7 creatures in his main deck, 4 of which are Nyxfleece Rams.
Interesting. He got the message from Ivan Floch loud and clear when he won the Pro Tour. Nyxfleece Ram will do some work. But it looks like there's a Hornet Queen in Josh Atalayden's hand. And Hornet Queen, a pretty good answer to a couple of copies of Prognostic Sphinx. All of the tokens it's creating.
Disdainful Stroke or Dissolve would... Nope, looks like it's in play.
I mean, he had just done the Thoughtseize to clear the way.
Oh, so. Sure.
He knows that there's End Hostilities, but he's now kind of forcing the issue in a way that previously he wasn't.
Right.
And Lars Dom,
Hornet Queen's so good.
Unclear quite how many win conditions he can afford to wrath away here.
Yeah, the main deck is 2 Sphinxes and a Pearl Lake. The sideboard has 1 more of each.
And with Whip of Erebos in Josh Atalayden's hand, and he now knows that the coast is likely clear from counterspells, this could be a big game-changing moment, because once Whip of Erebos lets you say, well, you can deal with Hornet Queen once, get it back, make a few more tokens, sooner or later you get to just sort of grind your way through, and that's sort of the Sidisi Whip way, I suppose.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, Whip Hornet Queen is one of the defining interactions in Standard. Lots of decks. You see Abzan decks running it, you see Black-Green decks running it, they used to be Devotion decks or Constellation decks. They're really Whip of Erebos decks, all of them.
And it falls to enchantment removal, it falls to artifact removal, it doesn't fall to a whole lot else. But there is the Dissolve from Lars Dom. He must have drawn that just on that one turn.
Yep.
Josh Atalayden thought he had a window.
Well, I mean, there were some scries involved in setting up his deck. But yeah. All right. So Lars stops the whip. That means that End Hostilities can at least get the board back to parity.
Josh Atalayden here, hitting his land drops. I mean, while Josh's deck wouldn't really be fair to call it a control deck, he certainly is a mid-range deck that goes big enough that hitting lots of land drops is not necessarily going to be a problem for him. Mm-hmm. Lots of Sultai action from that deck. But 2 copies of End Hostilities here. They're not in play, but given that both players know about them, these are kind of the defining features of this board to me at the moment.
Yeah, what Lars doesn't know is that Josh can counter the first one.
He has seen that Disdainful Stroke off Course of Crucifix, so there's this kind of big mind game going on where most of the information is known by both players, and this is really where you start to see the strength of players in this World Championship. I've seen more credit being given to opponents in lines of play here than just about anywhere, and it very well deserved. So Hornet Queen getting in here with a couple of insect tokens. They've all got Death Touch, which means that Lars Dom not too keen to be blocking here. I mean, I guess that Josh is really just looking to force the issue. What he doesn't know about is that there's another Anger of the Gods in Lars Dom's hand.
Oh, my. Yeah, Anger is the removal spell that Lars wants to resolve, because it can wipe away the Hornets without killing Prognostic Sphinx. And yeah, he goes for it.
Also, crucially, the creatures that it kills are getting exiled rather than just going to the graveyard. And while obviously that's not a big deal for the insect tokens, making sure that Hornet Queen is nowhere close to that graveyard so that if another whip comes along, it can't come back is certainly something he's not going to be too sad about.
Yeah, that's a great point. Yeah, both Sphinxes. Threatening lethal next turn. Josh needs to draw an answer.
And this, of course, potentially deciding the match, because Dom already up a game.
Yeah, I mean, Sultai Charm can destroy a monocolored creature. It can potentially stop one of the Sphinxes for one turn, but the fact that they can pick up Hexproof means that, you know, I mean, all Josh may be able to buy himself a turn, but that's all he gets to do.
And one of the other reasons, aside from the Sphinxes, Sphinges, I believe is the plural, being able to pick up Hexproof, is that all of that scrying means that Lars Dahm can be pretty confident of always drawing good cards for the rest of this game.
Right.
We can see here he's thinking about more copies of End Hostilities on the top of his deck.
It's like, which good cards do I actually need? He can see that Sidisi's coming. That's got to make the anger. The anger seems great. It's a question of whether he's pushing an End Hostilities. I didn't see what the third card was.
We'll, I'm sure, find out soon enough.
Well, pushing to the bottom.
Oh, okay. So there, it looks like maybe there was a Soul of Innistrad in activation. Kind of tricky when there's so many relevant zones and we can't necessarily fit everything on camera, but a couple of creatures going back to Josh Atalayton's hand there, including Sidisi. And that, I guess, one of the strengths of Sidisi Whip is that it uses its graveyard as an extra hand more than just about any other deck in the format.
Yeah, I thought Josh was basically dead here, but the fact that there's a Soul buying back a Hornet Queen, it's a good thing for Lars, he just found another anger. Yeah, and Josh not happy about this. Yeah, he had cleared a path with that Thoughtseize, like you said. Somehow, though, Lars just kept drawing gas.
Yeah, it doesn't count as a legendary top deck when you've set it up with that much scrying, but it does the job just the same. Lars Dahm there, picking up his second game win, so that the match there for him. He goes 2-0 up against Josh Atalayton, advancing to 6-5.
Loss number 6 for Josh. That's bad news.
Yeah, in spite of all the good work he did in Modern, which I'm sure is going to have ramifications far beyond this tournament.
True.
But this is our last match in the feature match area. On the left of our screen, we've got Jacob Wilson. On the right, Raphael Levy. The lone creature in play, that's a Stormbreath Dragon, kind of the top end of what the aggressive red deck from Raph Levy is doing. And if we're talking about players playing the decks that have been kind of their pet deck for the year, this pretty much where Raph Levy's been for a while now. He had Ravel Red back before Khans of Tarkir. He was then on red tokens, or sort of red-white tokens, I think, in Pro Tour Khans of Tarkir. He's been casting red spells for a while and being very successful with them.
There's the gold upkeep Magma Jet. Let me set my draw phase. I'm gonna set it with a Lightning Strike.
Yeah, there's quite a bit of scry in this deck. He's got, see there.
And there's the handshake.
Plenty of burn, able to finish things off. There was a giant strength in his graveyard already, so that Titan strength, sorry. So plenty of scry, just meaning that the red deck has a little bit more in the way of controlling options, a little bit more in the way of card drawing than normal. But that the end of our first round of Standard, and this was the only round, like the surprise round, if you will.
Yes.
The one where nobody knew what deck they were going to be facing. But looking at it, it seems like most people kind of went to type. They went with the decks that they're sort of well known for playing, if they have one.
Yeah, seeing what CFB was playing was a big deal. Mm. The fact that they're on Sidisi Whip, I don't know. I mean, the range of the decks those guys could have shown up with, I think, was quite wide. Turns out, it's Sidisi Whip. That's going to be a big part of the story. Big 6 loss for Jacob there, too.
Yeah, a tough one. And this is really the first round of the day where we're really starting to see people fall out and lose their opportunity.
I mean, we saw a bunch of 5-5s there. 6-5, I mean, 6-5, you're still in position to rattle off 3 wins. But 5-6, well, I mean, there's still some nice pro points. There's some nice money on the line for top 8, top 16. But that's what you're playing for now.
It's kind of cool that sort of at the Pro Tour, there are definitely situations where in the last round, there's not necessarily that much to play for. There's not that much opportunity to move around in the standings.
Yep.
Here, it's not just about the standings. All of these pro points, there's only 24 players that can get pro points at this stage in the season. And those pro points, they're going to add up later in the season about trying to get silver, trying to get gold, trying to get player of the year, potentially.
Yeah, there's thousands of dollars on the line, too. I mean, the difference between 5th and 9th, I think, is it's at least 1,000. It might be 2,000. So, big money games, big pro point games. But once you pick up loss number 6, it still feels like the stakes are a little bit lower.
Yeah, but I mean, some big victories as well. So a lot to be said for Sam Black managing to navigate his way through potentially quite a tricky matchup. The draws kind of worked out for him a little bit, but also some really solid play there in terms of figuring out what Ivan had going on. Lars Dahm has just been impressing all over the place. We saw Reed Duke made his sort of first big impression as a Magic Online Championship winner, and then
Sean McLaren as well.
Yeah, it's.
I'll throw you another one. You want to talk about Mox competitors and Worlds? Junya Ienaga qualified for the Worlds that he won in the last Mox qualifier. He only got to San Francisco because he was playing in the Mox, and he won like the last chance qualifier just to even play that Mox final. Playing the Mox, this is the Mox that Reed Duke wins, but you forget, Junya Ienaga was in that field, except what he really did that weekend is he won the World Championships.
I mean, either way around, you're doing all right.
But
if you have to choose...
Yeah, I'll take Worlds.
But it sounds like down on the floor, we might be able to get a chance to get a little interview with our last round winner there. Let's go down and see what he's got to say for himself.
Thanks, Tim. Shot Miller here. I'm here with Rafael Levy. Now, you're at a nice 9-5 record, and you brought your mono red deck here to compete in the standard portion of this tournament. How do you feel about your chances of either winning out or getting to the top 4 with the deck that you've chose?
Well, my chances are pretty slim. I have 2-3-0, and I'm not even sure I can make it. My tiebreakers are abysmal. They're really bad. But I feel much more confident in standard than I felt in modern. Modern, I really didn't know what to expect, and I won 3'd. But I feel much more confident in standard. That's the deck I've been working on for a long time. And, so far, so good.
All right, so the World Championship and the World Magic Cup are here in your home country of France. Now, I know you won the World Magic Cup last year, but you're not going to be on the team this year. Are you going to be sticking around to root on Jeremy Dasani and the rest of the French team?
I'll try to stick around and give my moral support, yeah.
Did you help out with any of the testing for the French team?
Well, we tested standard a lot, so we tried to figure out what the best decks were. And, hopefully the team found something. There are 3 other people in the team. It's not just Jeremy and me.
Right.
So they did their job. We did our job. I helped a little as much as I could, but hopefully that will be successful.
All right. So Rafael Levy sitting at 9-5, fingers crossed, see if he can win out and get some good, some help in the tiebreakers. So this is Rashad Miller, and we're going to send it back to the booth.
Thank you very much, Rashad. Hearing a little bit more from Raf Levy. Really, ever since last World Championships, Raf Levy has been more pumped about Magic than I've seen in a long time. Very, very proud to have been the World Champion of France. And he's had a banner year this year in terms of, you know, this is he did his first World Championship age 15, and he's just been rocking Magic ever since. But a great round for him here in round 11. But we're going to take a little break, head back to the news desk, and we'll be back with you very soon for round 12.
Thanks so much, Tim. Thanks very much to Randy Bueller. You see at the wall there, Sam Black and Brian David Marshall, they're getting ready for their deck tech. Sam Black doing very nicely at 7-4, now having defeated Ivan Floch, who falls to 6-5. That's close, we think. Round about the 6th loss may be critical. We wish to give you more definite. A lot of people tweeting us saying, can you not tell us exactly where we want to be for the record? We don't know. That's the truth. 9-5, we think, might be there. 8-6 is starting to look less likely as Patrick Chapin comes back to the field. There's the scoreboard. The matches that are in light color, they've already come in. Those are 11 matches worth of results. The darker names, they're still playing right now, which means by my count, 4, 5, 6, 8, 10, we've still got 5 of our 12 matches still playing. But why don't we look at where we are? Patrick Chapin at 9-2. Kentaro Yamamoto is alone at 8-3 right now, but will likely be joined by one of Shahar Shenhart and Yu Watanabe. And that's a pair and a half to be going at it. So we'll see who wins that one. Ivan Floch, you see, falls to 6-5. Lars Dam is up to 6-5. He's defeated Josh Utterleighton, who falls to 5-6 as a result. Raf Levy there, I think we got some confusion with our sixes and our nines. Upside down, 6-5 for Raf Levy. Listen, 9-5 is where he would love to be, because that could put him right on the verge of the top four. So 6-5 right now, three more wins would take him to his maximum potential of 9-5. Yuki Ichikawa still going, William Jensen. Now, I did hear a little bit of math going on in that game out on the floor, where William Jensen said, right, so gain 6, lose 2, right, yeah, 54. So there's some interesting life totals going on in that one. Further down the field, Reed Duke has won. He's up to 4-7, and that's at the expense of Nam Sun Wook, who falls into the bottom three alongside Li Shi Chan and Ray Perez Jr. But remember, all three of those, 3 pro points, that's like playing at a pro tour, and they've still got 3 rounds to go to try and generate some pro points. And of course, congratulations to all the 24 for being here. So lots more results to come in. The players still going here in the first round of standard, but we have a deck tech for you. And as you saw just a moment ago, waiting patiently at the wall, Sam Black, one of the great thinkers in the game today, and he is going to talk to one of the great talkers in the game today. He's going to kill me for that. Here comes Brian David Marshall.